This is Juliana Rani-Cobriz, and I'm back in part five with Stuart Matson, who's going to talk about his impressions of postmodernism. Go ahead.
So in the early 80s, when I was in graduate school,
In America,
in New York City, I got to know a French professor, Sylvère Lautinger, and Sylvère had a magazine called Semiotext, and Sylvère was bringing the French postmodern theorist to Columbia to talk. He brought in Foucault, he brought in Derrida, he brought in a bunch of people, and the concept of postmodernism was not only in Columbia was one of the first places where it showed up, but the art world was definitely embracing concepts of postmodernism. And so I was living in both of those worlds. When I moved into advertising, I carried that sort of quest of understanding what postmodernism was into my job. Because one thing I noticed is it definitely was generational. As I said, the boomers were very much modernists. And this next generation of Generation X were embracing concept of postmodernism. Whereas the modernists were very all about one unifying theory that explained everything. They're very optimistic. They're very much about progress. They're very much very rational and logical. Postmodernists were completely different. They kind of gave up the notion of progress. They were more cynical about the future. They were illogical. They were much more about, instead of having a very clear-cut story, they were much more about complexity, subtlety, and they're much more subjective than objective, as the modernists were. So it was a whole new world of, again, fluidity, complexity, and I found it much more interesting. So I continued to read the postmodernists, who are really, I mean, my education was as a social scientist and from a modernist perspective. So it was, and they were also translated from French, and a lot of the translations were really bad. So I was reading Foucault, I was reading Lacan, I took a course in Lacan, and stuff was really hard to get a handle of until I found this one book. It was called Postmodernism. I found it at the Museum of Modern Art, Postmodernism for the Social Sciences. And postmodernism started in the literature departments, started moving into, and of course, philosophy, and then moved into the arts, and then started moving into the social sciences. And so this woman, whose name was Pauline Rosenau, wrote a book where she basically took postmodern theory and explained it in a very rational, logical way. And that book completely explained it to me, so I really fully understood it. So I could, then I could basically communicate those ideas to my creatives in creating that work. And then also to the clients, because one of the issues that I had with my clients was we'd do a really interesting, rich, subtle, creative brief. The creatives would develop really amazing work that, and usually targeted to young people who are now embracing postmodernism. But my clients were, you know, 20 to 30 years older than the target. So they would always say, "I don't get it, I don't like it." And I would say, fine, you know, that's good. If you don't get it and you don't like it, it means it's going to work. Because, and my smarter clients would say, okay, I do understand that, but, you know, tell me more about this. So I developed a presentation about boomers versus Generation X and modernists versus postmodernism and postmodernists. And after I gave that presentation to them, which basically talked about the philosophical differences and the worldview differences between these two generations, and then also how that worldview impacted every aspect of their life in terms of the movies they listen to, movies they see, the music they listen to, the sports they do, the clothing they wear. I would basically give them a whole picture of this new audience that was their target. And after I gave them that presentation, they would let us do whatever creative we wanted. And so it really opened up the opportunity to do some really good work. And so that was happening in the mid 90s, where I was doing, I think, some of the best work that I did in my career.
In China.
And no, actually this was in New York, But so then when I moved to China, well, then what was happening then is it was moving to digital. And digital work, it just doesn't give you the opportunity to build this image and to do brand building like you can do with TV and print. Digital work tends to almost be regressing back to, well, at least in the early stages, and I think people are still learning how to be creative with digital work because it's a completely new medium. It's only been around for 15 years or so, and if not less than that. So I found the work less interesting, to, you know, the creatives. The whole life in advertising changed once it moved to digital. Now you have these offices that are one humongous room with 200 people, and they're all sitting at the same desk, and they're all just sitting there all day just typing on their computer. There's no energy, there's no fun. It became not fun.
And no contact with other people.
And yeah,
it's contact with the machine, isn't it?
And it was, and it's just deadly quiet. All you hear is tapping. When I worked in advertising, we were laughing, joking around. We were, you know, running off to, you know, 3-hour lunches where we were working, but we were having fun. We were having a lot of fun. And like people of my generation, people who I had worked with, were quitting. I mean, I had creative directors who were big creative directors making, you know, $20 million a year, who are basically saying, I don't want to work in this industry anymore because it's no fun. So they were actually all bugging off and going to LA to become screenwriters. So,
and what did you do?
So, and I moved to China.
Yeah.
So I basically see, yeah, this is no fun anymore. And
but
I moved
you weren't
to China.
Laughing and joking in China, though.
Well, in fact, actually, because China, social media was definitely a part of the mix, but the agencies were kind of like old school New York agencies.
Ah.
And that world was just developing. So it was sort of...
So you weren't the only one who moved.
Yeah. There were a lot of other people who moved, and there was a lot of energy there. I mean, people were just learning about this new industry. So it was... There was a lot of energy. But as I said before, the Chinese educational system is so bad, and they're really, it's basically all rote memory, and they're really almost not taught to challenge or to question authority. They're just taught to basically read it and, you know, regurgitate it back. So they're not creative thinkers, and they're not strategic thinkers because they haven't been taught.
What about today?
Still not. I mean,
really?
Yeah. I mean, most of the work they do, and they talk about intellectual theft, they basically copy it or steal it.
I know, they copy it. Yeah.
Copy and steal, and I think it's not a very creative culture.
So it wouldn't only be China; it would be Korea, Taiwan.
Actually, now the creatives that I worked with in China, none of them came from the mainland. Because the mainland is
where
really
did they come
far
from?
Over. They came. They were Chinese from Taiwan, Hong Kong. There are very few Chinese living in Korea, but it was mostly Singapore, Hong Kong, and Taiwan.
But working in China.
Working in China as the creative directors, because those cultures, Hong Kong is a completely different world than Taiwan.
Influenced by the Brits,
a much freer, open. A creative culture. Mainland China, they're basically peasants, and there's just not a lot of creativity there and culture there, actually.
Well, it's probably not their fault because they were dominated by Mao Zedong.
Yeah, and they were
and communism. So you weren't allowed to think.
You weren't
under communism.
You weren't allowed to think. You weren't allowed to challenge. And I think my educational career was all about challenging authority and coming up with new things.
Okay, thank you very much.